Greetings, it is I, Countess Narva Jacobin, Lord and Emperor of the Jacobin Empire, and welcome. It is time to continue my discussion on anime series, where I review them for you, and then let you know a few ways that you can use them in your Big Eyes Small Mouth games, your BESM games. I'll just give you a couple suggestions for that. Now the fact is, these suggestions do pertain to other role-playing game systems. You can definitely adapt them just as easily. The actual system part might be up to you. But the general suggestions I will give you work fine. So let's continue where we left off. I still have two more from this season, which I do think are really good ones to talk about. Recreator and Alice to Zoroku. I have one of your suggestions with Duel, the Parallel Troubled Adventure. And of course, one going back in time with Inu Battle wa Nichijo. All right, let's start, of course, with the two from this season and begin with Recreator. So with Recreator, we focus on Sota, a high school boy who dreams of creating his own light novel and sort of is in a position where he doesn't work on it as much as he wants to. But he's a big fan of anime, video games, all that sort of thing. So he's watching an anime on his tablet that's an adaptation of a popular light novel that he enjoys a lot. And he finds himself drawn into the world of that anime, where he witnesses a battle between the main character, Celestia, and this strange girl in a military uniform that he's never seen before. In the course of the battle, he gets injured and Celestia protects him, and the two of them are transported back to his world, to our world. He basically then begins to learn of this mystery of the military girl who's trying to gather the influence of many characters from various different sources who are now finding themselves trapped in our world, and then using them to basically take over the creators and force them to alter their worlds, the people's, the characters' worlds, the way they want to, basically making them ideal. Of course, Celestia resists this. She joins with a few others that believe that regardless of if they are created by these people or some other thing, they don't have a right to change their worlds. And so they battle against the military girl and her forces with Sota in tow. So this is, of course, an action. Lots of battles, fighting against the military girl, fighting against other characters from various sources. It's a little bit of a fantasy, definitely. There are those that use magic powers and magic abilities. There's also a sci-fi, we have mecha and things like that that show up because we have so many different sources for different worlds. Now I rate this one a 4. It's another one that I liked a lot. The more I dived into it, the more I enjoyed it, and I do recommend it. It's a very interesting one. Now, if you're using this in a BESM game, I'd recommend 400 points. You're going to make your characters, well, a group of fictional characters brought into what effectively would be the real world. Their abilities are only going to be their abilities. And your group of characters are going to be similar to the ones that ally with Sota in a way. They're going to be the ones that believe that they don't have a right to force the creator, regardless if they actually are influencing their world or not. Doesn't matter. Now, granted, they might want to meet with their creators, learn a little bit about these people that created them, if they truly created them, or just wrote about these worlds. It's hard to tell. There's arguments about it within the series, at least early on. But regardless, you can see that you as a character are going to have this relationship with your creator that you're going to hope to kind of develop, because it is sort of like a father figure to you. But you're also going to want to oppose those that would use them and abuse them. Basically, your GM's version of a military girl who's trying to use them to basically create perfect worlds. Perfect worlds for these characters, which is not really seen as right. Of course, along the way, you will determine the different connections between our world and these other fantasy slash fake realities slash sci-fi realities, all these other realities. And you should have an NPC like Sota to sort of be with your characters. Now let's move on to the next one from this season, Alice to Zoroku. So we focus on Sarah. She's a young girl who's an orphan, who has really no memory of her past, except this time that she spent at a research facility, a government one. Along the way, she finds out that she turns out to be one of these children with a power called Alice Dreams, which they can effectively make their imagination and alter reality, making it real. She sees the danger in this place and escapes. Along the way, though, she finally does manage to actually get away from them, even though apparently she's tried it before. She finally manages to. And she runs across this old man, Zoroku. This old man basically, eventually, with a little coaxing, takes her in and starts to look after her. And pretty much tells her, as much as she wants to get revenge on the facility and save all those other people, she should get strong enough to be able to do that. And there's where the series takes place, the two of them effectively living their lives together now. Now, it's a fantasy in a Greek. Sora has these ridiculously powers that are kind of almost magical in nature. It's also a little bit of adventure because you can see that she's not used to the real world. She's not used to a world like our own. She does have a little bit of sense because of some of the other kids, which actually had their memories a little bit from before they came to the facility, which helped her to integrate a little bit. But there's this level of adventure in everything she does. There's also a level of mystery to it because of the mysterious nature of her powers and the powers of all the other kids, and basically where she came from in her own past. This is another one I rate a 4. I've enjoyed this one a bit. It's great. I'm probably a few episodes behind on it, just because of scheduling, but I've enjoyed it, and it's been very interesting, the various storylines for it. Now, if you're using this as a best-of game, I would also recommend 400 points for this one. You're going to make your group of characters, of your players, a group of kids who escape from some kind of research facility, and they should have the Alice Dream power. Now, the lot of them are going to be sticking together, trying to get out into this world, trying to make their way in a world that maybe they don't have the best connection to. If they went to the facility, especially when they were young, they don't have that same connection to the world that many others have. There are things about it that are still mysterious to them, and discovering it and learning about it should be an interesting thing. They also will bond with a NPC like Zoroku, who's going to be looking after them and helping them integrate into the world, where they're going to grow up, grow stronger, and hopefully eventually get to the point in time where they feel like they can save the rest of their friends from the research facility. But it's a more, again, it's that story that they have to make themselves able to do it first. They can't just try to do it. They can't do it alone. They have to unite together. They have to learn about themselves. They have to learn not to rely on their abilities in their everyday lives. Something that these characters in the anime are crutched with. They rely on their abilities a lot. And getting away from that is very important. So let's move on and talk about Dual Parallel Lives Adventure. So this one, we start off with a number of years ago, a man discovers an alien artifact, and he basically gets told to throw it away by someone at the company he's working for. Here's where the interesting things come in. He makes a decision. In one decision, he throws it away. It's destroyed, it's gone. But he also has that decision of keeping it. You see, two parallel worlds are created around this alien artifact in an instant, because this artifact in the world he keeps it changes the course of humanity greatly. We focus on Kazuki, the student who ends up going to this website because he sees these shadows of giant robots fighting, and he has always been seeing those, and people just think of him as strange because he can see this, and he then gets transported to the other world. He gets transported there, where he ends up being recruited by this one side of these two warring factions to pilot a giant robot. And so our adventures begin, with one of his childhood friends coming along with him, and his adventures as a pilot and dealing with these two factions and the connections to his own world, hopes to return to that world, the problems between these two worlds, and the fact that the parallel nature of them and the connections between them have a danger to them that has to be solved. Now, this, of course, is a comedy. It's got a lot of funny moments, just little things that make it a comedy. It's a sci-fi. Parallel worlds, giant robots, things like that. Technology changes, especially in this other parallel world where we've got this technology change because of this alien artifact. It's, of course, a mecha, too. We have giant robots. So it's a version of sci-fi that has giant mechas. Of course, giant mechas could exist without it being really sci-fi, but that's really odd. And does occur occasionally, but still odd, but still. Giant mecha. Now, I rate this one a 3, just because I didn't get into it as much. I mean, I enjoyed it, definitely, I have to say. There's just, I didn't finish the series. Big spoiler there. Because it was a lot of years ago I watched some of it. A lot of years ago. It's one of those ones that I feel like maybe I should return, because maybe then I'll have a better opinion of it. The one I've had from years ago, I might still now that we've talked about it. It's gotten me interested in it again. But if you're using it in a Besson game, I would recommend 400 points. You're going to make your characters people from pretty much our world, or our version of the parallel worlds, and a group of characters that get sent to the other world, and they get embroiled in the war that's in there, going to one side and learning about the secrets, about the connections with our world, hopefully trying to find a way back to our world to escape from this other place, to maybe along the way find some of those secrets, find out what they can do to basically save both worlds, to undo some of the damage that's been occurring because of these connections and this alien technology that's sort of done bad things to the parallel world they've been thrown into. Now let's finish up today with Ino Battle wa Nichijo Keino Natake, or When Supernatural Battles Become Commonplace. So this series focuses on the members of the Senku High School Literary Club. Effectively, this club of 5 students has superpowers. Yep, it's as simple as that. They all mysteriously gain superpowers one day, and it's all this one club. They have to then deal with the fact that these have these superpowers as part of their daily lives, as no one else seems to have superpowers, at least until people that come to battle them, which then they battle against some other people with supernatural powers too, when they begin to learn that, hey, we're not the only ones with them. They're not a huge amount of people with them, but apparently not the only one. So, of course, this is an action. Supernatural power battles, well, superpower battles, various things where they train with their abilities, things like that. It's a good degree of a fantasy. They have ridiculous powers. Their powers tend to be really powerful, actually, if you actually think about the essence of them, but they always display them in a way that seems like your traditional superpowers. These are actually far beyond those in the actual level of degree they could use them if they chose to. It's also a romantic comedy, though. It is one male and 4 females that are part of this. Granted, one of them is on the younger side and is really just there as an informality because of the elementary school connected to middle school connected to high school kind of thing. Yeah, that's... But regardless, the fact is that these 5 bond together over the one guy who's pretty much the one guy in it. And it doesn't get to that harem situation a lot. It's a lot of them like him. And there's one that's particularly liking him. So there's one girl that's pretty much the girlfriend material where the romantic comedy between the basically actions between the two of them, because it's a lot of them, you know, like she can't quite confess, he can't quite confess, and they both have their eccentricities, which reflect very strangely on their powers, which results in a lot of comedic situations. And of course, the other girls kind of are around there. So, you know, that's another little 4th thing that are a little tiny bit harem, just because it's 4 girls and 1 guy. Only because of that reason. This is another one I rate a 4. I enjoyed it a lot. It's an interesting take on superpowers, and basically, that's the best way of saying it. Interesting take on superpowers. That you want to hide them, but still learn how to use them and figure out why the heck you get them just mysteriously one day. Now, if you're using this Besson game, I'd recommend 500 points for this one. Finally, a different point value. Well, for this one, you're going to make your characters basically members of the Senku High Literary Club or something similar. If you want to be a different high school, different location, different type of club, regardless, they're going to be the pretty much only members of this club. Again, you could always add an NPC or 2 if you really want to, but that depends on the number of players you have. Regardless, all the members of whatever club they have superpowers. Now, it's the point of managing these superpowers, still learning how to use them and the maximum amount of your superpowers, what they mean, while pretty much hiding them from normal society and keeping them to yourselves because you don't know how people would react to the learning of, hey, some people have superpowers. And maybe dealing with other people that have superpowers, which aren't always friendly, might do bad stuff to you, might be after you for whatever reason, try to get into battles or conflict with you. Trying to resolve those maybe peacefully, maybe superpowered fight, will be up to your characters to discern how they react. As being basically normal people in a world without superpowers, that just gained them all of a sudden. That's the kind of characters you're going to have. So, that's it for today. I went over four more anime series, giving you a review of them, and then giving you some suggestions on how you can use them and adapt them into a Besom game. As I've said, you could easily adapt these suggestions to any other role-playing game system. It's the system you will have to adapt. Easier than others, harder on easier on some, harder on others, but if you really wanted to, you could adapt it to any role-playing game system you wanted. Completely up to you. But if you have any questions, comments, anything you would say, anything you think I left out, please leave in the comments below. Please like, share, and subscribe. It's just for the channel, the empire, the work I do. If you want to show some extra support, you can always check out my Patreon, link description below. But regardless, until the next time, I bid you farewell.